Evet.
Thank you. The next topic is social sustainability.
Evet değerli konuklarımız, sıradaki oturumumuzun.
As I mentioned, social sustainability is the topic of this panel, and Türk Telekom is our sponsor. Here are our panelists, Chairman of the Board of FIBA Holding, Hüsnü Özyeğin, Chair of the Board of Doğan Holding, Begünhan Doğan Faralyalı, Co-founder and former CEO of Malala Fund, Şiza Şahit, Caucasus and Central Asia Business Unit President of Coca-Cola, Galia Freeman Molinas, co-founder of Spark Schools, Ryan Harrison. And the moderator is going to be Erdan Timur, the founder of NEF. Hello everyone. As far as I can see, the number of people in this room is diminishing, but this is an important topic. And it appeals mostly to bosses and businessmen alike, because it is going to be an enjoyable discussion. For 2 days, we have been talking about drops of water. Now, this discussion is going to be kind of like a river, not little droplets. I will make a brief introduction and make sure that the rest of the time is used by panelists, and we will try to adhere to the allowed period of time. If you want to define social sustainability, I can describe 2 points. Who were the most wealthiest people of Turkey 2 years ago? Can anybody answer? Not most of you would have a clue, I believe. If you think about Mevlana al-Rumi, who lived in the 13th century, and if you think about Confucius, these are people, although they lived a long time ago, they are known very well. In that regard, I would say that sustainability is not about trying to make your presence more noticeable, but fading out of the picture is more like sustainability if we approach the description from a philosophical point of view. I wanted to start with Mr. Hüsnü, but we also have some other guests. We have Mrs. Şiza, for example, who requires a better use of time because she has a flight to catch. I would like to listen to your story of Malala Foundation. What was your story? Because you have both an encouraging and tragic story, I know. What does Malala Foundation Fund do, and what is your objective when you were creating the fund, and what is your future plan?
Today, and I apologize, I have to leave a bit early. The conference is running on Turkish time, and my flight is running on American time, so I'm going to have to rush out soon. I guess I'll start by saying what an honor it is to be here in Uludag at this conference and with this distinguished panel, all of whom are doing incredible things in different ways to create a better world. And I think the most exciting trend in today's world is leveraging business and impact investing to drive social impact at scale. I think the world that we're entering in is a new world because we're no longer dividing impact into businesses that drive returns for shareholders and nonprofits that do good. But we're starting to understand that if we are to take on the most pressing challenges before us today, then we have to make sure that social impact is ingrained in the DNA of our businesses and in the DNA of our investments. And in fact, if we do so, we will have more successful businesses, given 9 out of 10 millennials wanting to work at a place with social impact. And given the undeniable fact that we're all in this together and we can no longer continue to drive business without regard for the impact that has on the environment and the world as a whole. To answer the question, I'll share a little bit about my story. I think everyone here has heard about Malala, the youngest ever Nobel Peace Prize winner, and I know that was a matter of deep pride for Turkey because she is an 18-year-old Muslim girl, and she showed the strength of women from the Middle East. Typically, when women from the Middle East are portrayed in Western media, it is as a victim, but Malala showed that women from the Middle East are strong and powerful and leading change against all odds. I was also born in Pakistan. I think similar to many of us here, I come from a very self-made background. My parents were born in a village in Pakistan, grew up very poor, managed to build their lives, and they, like a lot of you, learned that if we are to have a better country, we must educate the youth. So there was a time when my parents would spend half of their income just to make sure that I went to the best schools in the country. Eventually, that led to my path to the United States. I got a full scholarship to Stanford University, and I moved there. But at the time, there was rising violence in Pakistan, rising terrorism, and a town in the north called the Swat Valley. This was a town that Malala came from. It was a town that wasn't powerful. It wasn't something that most Pakistanis cared about. So when the Taliban took over, most Pakistanis said, that's fine, let them have this town. People weren't acting, people weren't reading about it, the government left, the military wasn't intervening, and the Taliban began to ban girls' education. I was at the time at Stanford University in the US, and it was horrifying to me that there was a part of the world so close to my own home where girls' education was being banned. So I reached out to schoolgirls in the Swat Valley. One of those schoolgirls was a brave little girl called Malala, and I brought them all out to the capital of Pakistan, and I shared their stories with politicians, with the military, with people of influence who could act to protect their education. Fast forward, the military did intervene. Swat Valley was once again brought under the control of the Pakistani government. The Taliban was, by and large, defeated. Schools reopened. Malala went back to school. She was 11 years old at the time. 5 years later, she was on her way home from school when her school bus was stopped, and two masked gunmen boarded her bus. They said, "Who is Malala?" And they then shot her in the head, as we know. They fired two more bullets, injuring her friends Shazia and Kainat. And Malala was critical. Her father called me. I flew in to be with the family and saw the potential to take what was then a tragic moment. So the news was covering this moment, and the headlines were, "Malala, the girl shot by the Taliban." And we said, this needs to be more than the story of another victim in the Middle East shot and silenced. And so we decided to speak up, to tell her story, and to create the Malala Fund, which has become an advocacy platform for girls' education. And I'll let my fellow panelists take it from here. Yeah.
Çok farklı bir hikaye.
Yes, that's indeed quite an interesting and different story. Right now, I would like to yield the floor, Mr. Hüsnü, because he is one of the, I mean, leaders of social responsibility in Turkey. I believe that economic order is coming to an end. That's what I believe, because the more people are dying, the more aware of the fact that this system is somehow breaking down. And from time to time, we are indeed questioning our consciousness and our morale from time to time, but unfortunately our consciousness is emerging only after we indeed experiencing such tragic events. You know, do you think that we are speaking about capitalism version 2.0? Do you think this is the time for speaking such change? And we know that you are indeed one of the leaders of the social responsibilities in Turkey, but you still believe that such events, such activities for social responsibilities are still not enough. Of course, companies are always speaking and discussing about the profits and the profitability ratio, but maybe we should rather focus on the social responsibilities much more with comparison to the profits of the company. Yes, please. Thank you very much. First and foremost, I would like to thank Capital and Economist magazines for organizing this summit, because we can easily observe that the quality of the summit is increasing in each year, and you can see that very quality speakers are also attending to such summits, and I'm quite grateful to that. And I believe as the Turkish people, we should also speak about and discuss about such social problems. Of course, we do our best for the social sustainability, but what we do is not enough. Because according to me, the social sustainability has three important pillars. One of them is the social aspect, and the other one is the economic aspect, and the third aspect is the environmental aspect. If those three aspects are not preserved, then the social welfare cannot be transferred to the next generations. If you ask me what is the definition of the social sustainability, I can define it as follows. The generations, all of the human beings, should live with the equal rights and within the peaceful conditions. I mean, as human beings, we may not be born with the same conditions as our counterparts, but if we have the equal chances, then we can fulfill our potential. That's what I believe. Thank you very much. You use your time quite efficiently. Right now, I would like to yield the floor to Ms. Begüm Handoğan, because you are one of the owners of one of the biggest media companies in Turkey. Of course, the support of the media to such social sustainability issues matter. Of course, leaders matter a lot. The visionary leaders are indeed dragging those social sustainability events, but I also know that media will indeed be shaping the public opinion about the social sustainability. And what is the role of the media in terms of shaping the public opinion with regards to social sustainability? First and foremost, I would like to extend my gratitude to each and all of you before starting to my speech. Uludağ Economy Summit is indeed an important platform in which we have the chance to discuss about the opportunities, although we have such difficult times in Turkey. So I believe we are cracking our shells and we are broadening our horizon, and we listen to many inspirational speeches and we dream about the good things to be realized. That's why I hope that you will be able to dream even more painfully in the future, and hopefully such an appropriate environment for dreaming will be established in the future. Sustainability is a complex concept, but our previous speaker has defined it very well. I believe that social sustainability should be internalized by each individual, because sustainability means not thinking about only about today. We should also think about the future, because this world is being transferred to us from our ancestors, and we should protect this world and give this legitimacy to the next generation. We should convey this legacy to the next generation. We have many responsibilities and many duties with regards to that. And the media has a huge responsibility. Media should obey the ethical rules. And media should, of course, serve to the needs and the society of one country. The right of a free expression is quite important, because if the individuals lack the freedom of expression, then many of the societies will suffer. There are many indexes which are expressing it. Norway, Denmark, Sweden has one of the most developed countries with regards to freedom of expression. And in terms of the, Human Development Index, again, Denmark, Sweden, Norway are top three countries. Of course, this is not by chance, because we know that if the ideas freely travel around a country, then the social development of such countries will be even higher, of course. As I said at the beginning of my speech, the media should have some criteria, should have some ethics. I do believe that the media should also have its conscience. The media should always ran after the truth. And the media should, of course, not violate the personal rights and personal freedoms. And the media should have an economic independence, by the way. If we expect something from the media, if we want media to function its duties, then the members and the representatives of the media should commit themselves to their jobs. Only after that, the social development might be taking place. I would like to say one more thing. As you can observe, there is a huge polarization in Turkey right now. A recent study has been published about this social polarization in Turkey. Unfortunately, 80% of our citizens do not want to get intimacy with other citizens who vote for other political parties. This is quite dangerous, and this is quite concerning. We know that we have many common values. Although we might vote for different political parties, we have many commonalities as the Turkish citizens. When I speak with a policeman from Adana, or when I speak with a teacher from Ankara, I believe that we want the same thing. But all the same, we still observe such a dangerous polarization in Turkey. And I ask the question, why? Why such kind of a polarization exists? And I believe some of the members of the press, some of the media members are also contributing to the polarization. We always discriminate between people. We always use the hatred discourse, and this is quite a huge obstacle for the social development of our country. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Yes, of course, our values are sometimes corrupted. But unfortunately, when the values are being corrupted, when the values are being degraded, we can be aware of it only at the very latest stages. And this is one of the biggest problems of the capitalism. That's what I believe. And this is not the only problem of Turkey. We see such problems in Greece. For example, populist leaders might totally steer the country to another direction. Because, I mean, if we try to manage things only based on our personal interests, then, nothing good can come out of it. And if that's the case, then the human beings should indeed eliminate the degradation of the values. But unfortunately, we are aware of such problems at the very latest stages, when the corruptions and when the value degradation is taking place, then at the end, when there is even almost no solution, we are aware of that. Right now, I would like to yield the floor to Galia Molinas. And of course, when we are speaking about the social sustainability, there are also some companies which are defining their priorities according to the social sustainability. Uber and Airbnb is a good example because these companies are connecting their business with the social impact. And Coca-Cola is also one of the pioneers with that regard. We know that, those companies which are creating a social impact, although they are new, is taking a huge share also in the market. So in order to change this unequal income distribution or such unfair society, do you think that the companies which will prioritize social impact in their business, and I also would like to tell us about the social sustainability perception of Coca-Cola, and what is your perception about those issues? And the floor is yours. Thank you very much. I would like to congratulate Uludağ Economy Summit because the Uludağ Economy Summit is also quite sustainable. So before proceeding with my speech, maybe we should give an example from Milton Friedman. In 1960s, Milton Friedman wrote a book, and he said that the aim of the business world, the only social responsibility of the companies are to increase their profits. That's what he said. But right now, we don't have such a world. Because right now, we are speaking about economic sustainability and the sustainable profit growth. And this is indeed being shaped by three important aspects. Hüsnü Özyeğin spoke about environmental, economic, and social impact. These three aspects are being considered by the companies. And right now, companies are changing their ways of doing business. They are integrating sustainability to their priorities. We know that the business world has huge capabilities in terms of creating a social impact. And there are two, institutions which are creating the social impact. One of them are the politicians and the other one are the business world. So there is this leverage effect when we are speaking about the social impact. We see that many of the companies are entering into corporate responsibility projects, corporate social responsibility projects. But when the social needs are intersecting with the know-how of that company, then a huge social impact is emerging. The question was asked by the moderator to me about the perception of the social sustainability, and I would like to answer on behalf of my company. We have the principle which is called triple W, wellness, woman, and water. This is what the triple W is standing for. So with regards to water and the woman, we are indeed changing our ways of doing business based on these two aspects. Let me give an example in order to indeed concretely example this situation. For 2020, we have an aim and we want 5 million more women to be employed. Up to now, we were able to, find jobs to 1 million women. And when we are finding job opportunities for many women, we only utilize our own networks, starting from our supply chains and also from our training capabilities. We are trying to disseminate these values to different stakeholders within the social sustainability. Water, is a very important topic that we should be careful about, because no matter what we drink, the core of what we drink is the water. And we don't want any water scarcity to emerge in the future. That's why when we are producing, we are always taking the sustainability into consideration in terms of the water as well. Of course, these are about the social responsibility projects, but also internally, we try to increase our sustainable production. Just like Uber and Airbnb, we are trying to create new business models in order to increase our sustainability. I can give you a couple of examples from my own company. We always question ourselves to create to social impact in the society. As you all know, in 2010, Haiti experienced such a devastating earthquake. And one of the main resources of Haiti, as you all know, is agriculture. They are producing mango specifically. Approximately 3 months after the Haiti earthquake, within the brand of Audula, we indeed developed a sub-brand, a sub-Haiti brand. And for the mango juice producers in the Haiti community, we supported them. So this sub-brand that we created, of course, earned money, and all of the income which is generated with that brand has been given to Haiti as an aid. So by doing such activities, we are trying to contribute to different societies, but of course, as the business world, we have a lot to do in the future. Thank you very much.
As I said in the beginning, Mrs. Shiza is leaving, so I would like to ask her second round of questions. So could you give us some recommendations about social sustainability, because we are businessmen here and you have a different outlook.
Thank you. And I want to apologize, Ryan. I was looking forward to hearing you speak as well. And I've heard wonderful things about your work. And I was looking forward to hearing more from all of the esteemed panelists. So I hope I'll get to continue to be part of this conversation. Recommendations, I honestly believe that it's not enough to look at the world as divided into two groups, businesses that are only bound by their responsibility to fiduciary, their fiduciary responsibility to shareholders, and nonprofits that have social impact. There's not enough resources that way, and there's not enough innovation, and there's not enough talent. And as we look at the challenges that exist today, they are highly complex, and the simplistic solutions that we've believed in are often not working. In fact, the greatest social innovations that we see, the greatest examples of social impact, have by and large come from businesses, whether it's mobile technology that enables those who don't have access to banks to make financial transactions, to save money, or whether it's education and the way in which we're able to overcome a lack of qualified teachers and a lack of local talent and a lack of capacity through online learning. And we're just scratching the surface of what is possible. So I would urge everyone to reimagine the world and reimagine their businesses. I think if I were to ask everyone here, raise your hand if you believe that your life was meant to leave the world better than you found it. I think everyone would say yes. I was born to make the world better, and yet we've made it very difficult to do that through the realm of business. And we've started to believe charity is the only way to do good, and that's simply not true. We have more power in our smartphones than a US president or a Turkish president would have had 30 years ago. We have more information in our smartphones than was ever imaginable. So we owe it to ourselves to reimagine the world, to reimagine our impact, and to live passionately. And thank you again for having me. I'd love to continue the conversation. And if you'd like to reach out, my contact information is on my website, which is just my name, shazashahid.com. And I look forward to being back here again another time. Thank you. Siz...
Kulaklığı...
Maybe you can keep the headphones because Mr. Hüsnü is going to say something about the fund.
Okay. Yeah. Shiza, siz ayrılmadan önce...
Before you leave, Shiza, I would like to say something about Malala Fund. Because we are doing something that is probably in parallel to what you have been doing. About 12 years ago, we visited the Ministry of National Education as Hüsnü Özyeğin Foundation, and we addressed the issue of schooling rates of females. We had numbers about different provinces, and the province of Ağrı had the lowest participation ratio of females at schooling age. We gave that knowledge to the Ministry of National Education, and probably I can say that that was the beginning of our solution process. With their help, we started building schools for those girls who did not have access to schooling. Also, next to physical facilities of secondary schools, we started expanding the educational possibilities, because the girls there were engaging in marriages as early as at 13 to 14 years of age. We moved these girls from their small villages and located them in close vicinity of secondary schools. We created sororities for them. In the province of Ağrı, then in the district of Doğu Beyazıt, Patnos, Siverek, Midyat, in these places we built 25 sorority dormitories. And now, although they were intended to marry a man as early as at the age of 13 to 14 years of age, if left alone, we have now made sure at least 52% of them are attending schools. If we had not taken those girls from their villages and brought them to the dormitories we built in close vicinity of secondary schools, most of them would still remain in their villages with a husband that they were introduced to at a young age. We have been talking about the issue of equality of opportunities and violence against women in Turkey. But the primary solution to that problem is giving them the means to access education. So we are doing our part similarly. Thank you, Shiza, for your participation, and have a good trip. Right now, I would also like to apologize to Ryan because we skipped his speaking order. You have a schooling incentive in South Africa. I would like to ask you why you chose South Africa and what you have done in there so far. Also, what kind of values were the building blocks for you when you decided on doing this? There is a saying by Yunus, a scholar, if you are thinking hard about the world, your trouble is as big as the world, is the saying. So just like Shiza said, doing your corporate business is not any limitation for you to create a social impact. You can do them together. So what is your outlook about that?
Thank you very much for having me. It's awesome to be here with such an esteemed crowd. It's fantastic to have education front and center. For such a long time, education's kind of been back alley. It's been NGO, non-profit work, very unsexy. And for the first time, we're seeing education become something sexy. We're seeing people that were never involved in education before wanting to get into it. We're seeing investment bankers. We're seeing MBA grads. We're seeing the creme de la creme really moving into the industry. And it's because of these kind of platforms that's happening. So a huge thank you. South Africa, like all emerging markets, is really struggling with delivering relevant education at the moment. Different from most emerging markets, South Africa has quite a high GDP per cap. So it seems reasonable to expect that we would be able to deliver high quality education. But unfortunately, we're not. In last year's Global Economic Forum, the Global Competitiveness Report, South Africa scored 144 out of 144, so last in the whole world for maths and science. The every rand and every dollar we're spending just isn't translating into high quality at all. Actually, most of our neighboring countries with GDPs a fraction the size of ours are outcompeting us on education. And really, this is why Spark started. It started with a few core concepts, but at the heart of it all, the desperate need to disrupt education. And people over the last day and a half have spoken quite a lot about disruption, about the need for new business models. But one thing that we really learned early on was you cannot, if you're going to disrupt a market, use people in that market. And for that very reason, the entire founding team and our entire executive committee, not one of them, comes from education. Because you cannot take the people that created the problem and expect them to fix it. It's a very, very difficult thing to think about, but all the disruptive innovations in the world didn't come from the people that created the problem in the first place. And that inertia, that risk, that leap of taking people that may know nothing about education and entrusting them with the future of education is something that's critical and key to Spark. You asked me a little bit about our founding values, and we're a non-denominational school network because we want to scale not only through South Africa, but into Africa, South America, India. And we knew from the very beginning, as soon as we associated our school with a denomination, with a religious affiliation, it would limit our ability to scale. It would make us less relevant, less meaningful to a much broader society. And at the end of the day, all parents want a great education above all else. So we've founded our school on a set of five values, and that's what Spark stands for. The S for service, P for persistence, A for achievement, R for responsibility, and K for kindness. And those values, not only do we expect our children to live by, but also all our staff. And it permeates our culture, it permeates everything that we're about.
Thank you.
Now, now maybe we can go into better detail. Mrs. Begum, I would like to ask you a question. Well, we are sharing our opinions, and most of the time we are agreeing with each other. That is something, but we have to do better than that. Maybe we need to create a change in our values. Maybe the starting engine should be different, because currently, in terms of creating social impact, we are driving a car that has a broken engine, as far as I can see. Maybe we should change the engine. Is it the answer? There is this saying, this quotation, if you are setting off on the road with love, your burden is going to be the world itself. We have Seyitonbaşı, for example, a leading figure of our War of Independence. He has a really notorious photograph where he is holding a large artillery bullet. And later on, they ask the man to do it again so that they take another picture. He can't do it. But in the heat of the battle, he does it. Maybe it is just like that in companies. People found companies, of course, they become gears of the capitalism. They want to earn money out of what they have invested. This is only normal, and we cannot expect them to do otherwise. But probably they are starting off with the wrong values. Maybe they don't have the instinct. Maybe we can create the biggest company of the world, but without any social impact, it will be only as good as your social profitability for your own individual ends and goals. What is your outlook and perspective, Mrs. Begum? So what do we see all around the world? We were striving to develop as countries and companies, but in the meantime, as societies, we turned into consumption machines. And this turned us into a world where less is more. This is a paradigm shift. And I believe our individual awareness levels need to be reworked. In Sufism, in this philosophical movement, as you know, it is understood that every single human being is one. But on the other hand, in this current world, everybody is supporting the idea of individualism. People are forgetting that they are one. We need to change the world in that direction. Global economy has been attributed a lot of importance for years. Competition and innovation have been points to discuss, but economy is not global alone. Problems also globalize as economy spreads over the world, and you cannot ignore them. The refugee crisis, for example, at its current situation, while some people on the other side of the world are consumption machines, on the other side of the world, people are living on the streets, hungry and sleepless. And I'm talking about 5 million people, children and adults alike. I believe it's all a matter of individual awareness levels increasing, although that is not enough. By the way, some good things keep happening. We need to keep up our hopes. While we are talking about sustainability, it's a good thing alone that we are discussing it. The UN, for example, has outlined 16 sustainable development goals at the end of 2 years of survey. These include equality of genders, access to the same quality level in education, and elimination of hunger. And these are only some of the values. This can change the entire world. Also, in the meantime, there are some companies which are already implementing these values. On the other hand, there is a sustainable business council which includes 30 people from all around the world. It is led by Paul Polman, CEO of Unilever, and I am a member too. These 30 people are concerned with the idea of incorporating social responsibility to the primary business models and strategies of their enterprises. Social responsibility, as we foresee it, should be a part of business plans and models. On the other hand, we try to inspire governments and countries so that they go hand in hand with these companies. Hopefully, we are going to launch pilot projects in the upcoming 8 months with the help of non-governmental organizations and governments. They will gather around the same table for the purpose of creating social impact. In 2017 at Davos, we are going to launch the planned projects, and hopefully they will yield good results for us, and they will be internalizing these values for all businesses.
Hemen Hüsnü Bey'e geçmek.
So without further ado, I would like to continue with Mr. Hüsnü. What is your evaluation about the social sustainability? Because we would like to hear what you have to say. Jean-Pierre Morgan, you know, who gave all of its indeed money away, you know, the founder of the J.P. Morgan. Jean-Pierre Morgan was indeed the banker who financed the Titanic ship. But during that time, unfortunately, he had cold and he couldn't get on the ship. When he died, he had the, I mean, the, you know, $50 million of money, and together with the inflation adjustment, that inheritance will be about $50 billion. And he left only $4 million of his inheritance to his children, and he left $3 million to his son. And he says that, I mean, maybe my bank will need some extra financing. And he also left some money for his wife as well. And he left his captain the ship. And since one of our, I mean, attendants are also dealing with the maritime affairs, he will most probably appreciate it. But the rest of the money of J.P. Morgan was left to churches, hospitals, and etc. So right now, the big businessmen are not only thinking about their country, but they are thinking about the globe. For example, Bill Gates, Jeffrey Sachs, these are the examples. And they understand that whenever there is an epidemic like Ebola, which emerged in the Africa, they will have effect all around the world. For example, the refugee crisis, which is popping out of Syria, will have impact all around the world. Daesh, ISIS, for example, had unfortunate consequences in Turkey, in Brussels, all around the world. And unfortunately, there are some people, there are some husband and wife from California who goes to Daesh, who goes to ISIS, although they are not trained, and they are indulging in those terrorist activities. So we should also think about such unfortunate events when we will establish the social sustainability. So I believe what we are doing is more important than earning money, and education matters a lot. And I do have a university, as you know. In the Özyeğin University, we have courses in the curriculum of the students about social responsibility. We have a courses like that. And in the district of Tatvan in Turkey, we have a project of rural development In the Nizip district of Gaziantep province, we also have rural development projects. Our students are going to those districts and they are working for the rural development. Our psychology students, for example, are doing some social responsibility projects for the addicts, for the substance addicts, for example. So our psychology students are going to such districts and they are trying to heal the addicts of paint thinner. We also have the volunteers of FIBA, the FIBA holding volunteers, and we give them 3 days off from their work, and for that 3 days off, they are going to attend those social responsibility projects. And right now, we also see that the foundations are also collaborating with each other in terms of the social responsibility projects. In the past, this was not the case. For example, Sabancı Foundation is supporting Açev. Açev Foundation is supporting the Foundation of Vodafone. Or, I mean, those foundations are also collaborating with the private companies as extensively as you might think. So. Anyway, when we go back to the issues of sustainability, I believe rural development matters a lot because we should train the farmers or the rural people in place. In Tatvan district, for example, we spent $3 million of money. We opened a new school. And this school is indeed using the solar energy. And maybe this is the only example in Turkey. We also planted many walnut trees. We also tried to develop the livestock in the region. We established a system for the collection of the milk from the cows. And I mean, we established such an environment in which we always try to develop the rural places. And for the for example, at the same region, we indeed try to increase the collection of the honey. 50 women in the region are dealing with the bee culture and beekeeping, the apiculture, and we are sending many of the honeys to many of the people. Did you receive our honey, by the way? If you didn't, if you didn't receive our honey that we produced, I will send you next year. You are on my list. So you understand what I mean. I mean, we are also helping this village to market their products that they produced. I believe this is one of the, I mean, most beautiful thing that we can do for our society. And this is quite thrilling and this is quite exciting. I recommend such social responsibility projects to each and all of you. Of course, there are many other groups who are doing the same social responsibility projects. Thank you. We are keeping up with our time. So I would like to thank to our panelists once again. I would like to turn to Ms. Galia right now. Don't you see such a potential in this room that we can really implement a paradigm shift, a mentality change, because we are always speaking about such kinds of a paradigm shift. And maybe the Coca-Cola might be the pioneering force, the driving force for resolving the main problems all around the world. Maybe Coca-Cola might come up with a budget allocation, and that maybe the Coca-Cola might say that, okay, this is the budget to resolve the problems of the world. You know, philanthropism is indeed one of the trends. Through such philosophy, many of the people, many of the donors are donating their money for the resolution of the problems. Maybe Coca-Cola might advertise such philanthropism, because if we only, I mean, focus, if we have a problem, then this is not going to be the solution. Because I mean, we should, for example, feel the problems of the refugees as just like as our problems, because I mean, if we think about our even morality, if we focus on our morality, maybe the Coca-Cola might be the driving force here. Okay, you speak about sharing what we earn, but I don't think the social sustainability is about philanthropism. Because, you know, business world has some targets, has some aims, and many of the institutions, many of the companies are here having their foundations. But I believe the social impact that we should create should not be connected to philanthropism at all. I mean, as long as the businesses and the enterprises are operating, we should create an impact with the production that we create. And I mean, the impact that we created should not only satisfy the financial stakeholders. I mean, the impact that we created should give benefit to the whole society. And this impact and this benefit should be sustained on a continuous level. I believe this is a matter of existence. This is a matter of survival. Because the problems that we are seeing right now is directly related to the matter of survival. The companies, the institutions which are not discussing about the social sustainability issues will not exist in the future, because we are experiencing an era in which such a extraordinary transformation is taking place. The new generations are being raised with such values, such social sustainability values that we are speaking about. If you want to sell your products to those new generations, you have to understand their value perception. I believe this is a matter of existence. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, Ryan, last but not least. Maybe I can ask this question to you. In South Africa, as you know, South Africa is far away from the refugee problem. How the South Africa perceives the refugee problem, the refugee crisis, and is there some foundations which would like to deal with the refugee crisis which is taking place far away from the South Africa? Because in some places in the world, I mean, those places are burning. How the foundations in the South Africa perceives the refugee crisis?
That's a big question. South Africa is
very far away. I need a short answer.
South Africa is very far away, and the refugee crisis you're referring to doesn't affect us because we're just so far away. But we have our own immigrant crisis, South Africa being kind of the land of milk and honey for at least sub-Saharan Africa. Most significant amount of people from our neighboring countries, Zimbabwe, Namibia, and then further north, Zambia, Malawi, Kenya, they come down to South Africa in search of a better life. In many ways, similar to the American dream, people are migrating from their homelands into South Africa, crossing the borders in many ways illegally, and just hoping that they'll find something, because something in South Africa is better than nothing in their home countries. And in many instances, they're giving up everything, their land, their families. And it's creating a huge issue. And in South Africa, one of the most negative consequences it's had is that it's created something we call xenophobia, which essentially is the South African local communities reacting negatively to foreigners to the extent where they've started to kill each other, huge issues around distribution of wealth in many ways, because the people coming into South Africa have taken such significant steps, moving thousands of kilometers away from their homes. They're often the most hungry. They're the ones that are starting the businesses. And this has fueled a kind of internal distrust of foreigners, a kind of internal hatred, and it's resulted in xenophobia. So to answer your question, is South African foundations or South African people focused on the refugee crisis? No, we look at it on the media, but we have our own immigrant crisis that South African foundations are trying to solve every day, and it's really come down to mindset. The xenophobia issue is affecting us significantly, and it's a huge battle that we haven't even started to win yet.
Thank you.
Thank you. Perfect timing. I believe we obeyed our schedule very well, and without violating the rights of any other speakers, we finished our session. So, last words from my side. Changing the business model is, of course, important because the new generations are being raised with such values, but I believe we should also internalize those values. For example, why don't we just think that, I mean, after you before you die, maybe you can donate some of your money to such charitable foundations, and such kind of problems will not indeed take place. I believe I am 33 years old. I established my company, founded my company in 27 years old. And I mean, we donated many money to many social sustainability projects, and my company is growing anyway. Of course, when you founded the company, you will have growth targets, you will have targets about the profits, but you should always have that second plan. You should be able to give up what you earn. You will either fade away or you will become extinct. So, I mean, you should fade yourself away, as the, I mean, Sufi philosophy requires. I mean, in the previous sessions, but as I said at the beginning of my speech, we only speak about the drops of the problems. But when we speak about the oceans of the problems in this session, which is the social sustainability, many of the people left the room, unfortunately. But I do believe that we should discuss about those issues all the time. And it is quite honorable to listen to the ideas of different speakers. Thank you very much. The end of our session. So last but not least, you should also to take some debts, and you should also donate your debts, by the way. Thank you. Thank you very much to all of our speakers. You gave so many spiritual messages.